We have our esteemed guest, Mr. R. Sridhar, Executive Vice Chairman and CEO, Indostar Capital. We've also got Mr. Shankar of IBM, who's an industry partner, financial services. We at Business World hope to have a great learning experience from today's interview. Once again, a warm welcome to you, Mr. Sridhar. Before we dive deep into our discussion, I would like to request you to please tell us something about yourself. Over to you, Sridhar sir.
So let me first thank Business World for this opportunity. And, you know, as far as my profile is concerned, I am a chartered accountant by qualification. Coming from Salem district, Tamil Nadu. And I moved to Mumbai in 1986. So it's about 35 years I have been living in Mumbai. And I have, you know, in my formative years, I have come up the hard way. Being born in a farmer family with the volatile income flows. So we moved to Chennai in 1965 when I was 7 years old. And by the time I finished my schooling, I had to start working to support my education as well as my old parents. So I had the proficiency in typewriting and shorthand, because those days, the moment you finish the schooling, particularly in South, which is more service minded. So for the girls, they will say music and dance and cooking. For the boys, it will be typewriting, some sports, shorthand and all that. So I took that, and I had a neighbor chartered accountant who started the practice. So I was doing some part-time, earning some 50-100 rupees, and was supporting my family. I was good in mathematics. I finished my BSc maths with distinction. And then I was working in a seafood export company. Immediately I got a job for 500 rupees as a clerk, because the chairman was impressed with my mathematics and he said that we require you to join. But being a pure vegetarian Brahmin, I found it difficult to work in a factory which has complete seafood. So I couldn't bear the smell. But at the same time, fortunately, the chartered accountant with whom I had a part-time working, he said that you are good in education. So we will all support you. Why don't you further study and join as an article clerk in my firm? So I joined, and then I was working three shifts, morning 8 to 10 and 10 to 6, and then evening 6 to 8 in different places. As an accountant, as a typist, as an article clerk. So I could manage 400, 500 rupees per month. And then I studied, and I came out successful in chartered accountant in 1983. When I was doing a part-time job in a cultural institution, there I met my chairman of Shriram Group, Mr. Tyagarajan. He was a treasurer in that institution where I had a lot of interaction. So impressed by my hard work and smartness, he said that, why don't you join Shriram Group? So this happened in 1983 when I passed out CA. So Shriram had the largest chit fund company at that time. But I was very reluctant to join a chit fund company being a chartered accountant. I felt it's not good for me to join a chit fund company. But he said that I will shift you to another company, NBFC, in next 1 year. So you join. So similarly, I worked for 1 year. And then in 85, he shifted me to higher purchase NBFC, Shriram Transport. And I came to Bombay as a branch manager after working as a field officer in Nellur, Andhra Pradesh, for 1 year. So 85, 86, I worked in Nellur as a field officer, which is the lowest position in the company. After becoming a chartered accountant, I worked there to learn the business. And then he shifted me as a branch manager to Bombay. And I came in 86, and then I was very successful in building business for Shriram Transport. And in 94, I became a regional head. And in 2000, I became a CEO of the company. So in 2000, the company's market capitalization was 20 crores. And in two terms, in 10 years, in 2010, I took it to 20,000 crores. So the market cap went up by 1,000 times. Similarly, the asset size was 2,000-3,000 crores in 2000. And I took it in 10 years to 50,000 crores. So Shriram Transport still is the largest asset financing NBFC in a niche business. So we were financing small road transport operators as well as used vehicles, pre-owned vehicles. Both have been considered risky by the marketplace. So my job was to create a perception in the minds of the institutional investors as well as institutional lenders that this business is niche. So I changed the mindset, and then the same business was looked as niche business. Only Shriram Transport has got the expertise. Then the market cap started increasing. So that has been a very successful career for me. And then I moved to Chennai for 2 years in the holding company as a CEO. I was with a large private equity Texas Pacific group, which is called TPG. So I was senior advisor for about 2 years in Bombay. And then the opportunity to head Indostar came in my way through Everstone, which is the promoter company of Indostar. So Indostar is another NBFC, which was engaged in financing corporate lending business and SME. So I came in, started two new businesses of commercial vehicle and affordable housing. And last 4 years, I've been working in this company. And we listed this company after I came in within 1 year. And then recently during the peak lockdown and pandemic, we brought a global partner, Brookfield, as our equity partner. And in the next 5 years, we would like to take this company as a evolving, emerging, strong NBFC in the country.
You know, enormous amount of opportunity to learn from your vast experience, and you know, particularly so impressed with how you kind of, you know, succeeded both in your personal life as well as professional life. And you know, the number tells the story. What better than, you know, these numbers that you shared with us? Amazing, actually, mind blowing. But great. So, you know, having spoken about the greater success in the NBFC sector that you've achieved, or you've been helping organizations that you've been serving, working with, achieve, my question to you is that, you know, do you agree the modernization is a necessary component for digital transformation in financial institutions? And if yes, what kind of opportunities it may create?
See, NBFC industry has faced multiple challenges in the last 3-4 decades. And government as well as the regulators have always praised in every forum the role played. But without a commensurate support or recognition. So we have always been categorized as shadow banks. The industry had the feeling of a stepmotherly treatment vis-a-vis the banks. So, in spite of all this, there had been an inbuilt resilience in the industry. So, NBFCs, if you look at thousands of NBFCs are there, which have been given license by Reserve Bank. But if you look at the asset size, 15 or 20 maximum NBFCs, have got the 90% of the assets. Balance 10,000 of NBFCs have got the balance 10%. So we have always been in discussion with the regulators and government to give us a relaxation and more regulation, but at the same time allow some privileges. The industry has never shied away from regulation. But we have been demanding level playing field and privileges. But it's still yet to come. And in that environment, we have been operating. So in the last 2.5 years had been the recent challenges. You know, the challenges have been every 10 years it has been coming. In 1998, the challenge came via a CRB finance company, which failed. And that triggered a more stringent regulation. So prudential norms have been introduced by Reserve Bank in 1998 when they brought in capital adequacy, income recognition, plus NPL norms, which was not there till that time in the NBFC industry. So that brought NBFC industries to seek license from RBI. Supervision, surveillance and inspection improved. And subsequently in 2008, 10 years later, you know that there was a Western liquidity crisis. So that time there was no money. And that again, with some support, NBFCs survived. And that brought down number of NBFCs. There were many NBFCs, which each industrial house had one NBFC. You take any industrial house in the country, everyone had one NBFC. I don't want to name, but today none of them exist. They all have been washed out in that liquidity crisis, and that reduced the number of NBFCs later. In 2018, exactly after 10 years, the ILFS happened, and that brought not only liquidity crisis, but the trigger was credibility crisis. So ILFS has been misunderstood by the market, particularly the mutual fund, which lent at least 1/3 of the total resources in the NBFC industry came from mutual funds. And so mutual funds felt that NBFCs are dangerous, risky, so they stopped. And whatever money NBFCs raised have also to be repaid. So it created a crisis. But NBFCs survived. Within 6 months, things normalized. Growth came down. But unfortunately, it was followed by multiple challenges. GDP shrinking, CV down cycle, and then on top of it, a pandemic. So March 20, government announced complete lockdown. We all thought that it would be for 3 weeks, but 3 weeks has now become 18 months. So it was March 20, now we are in September 21. We are still talking about COVID-3 coming. Curbs are there, but during this 18 months, things have slowly, gradually improved. But during this period of pandemic, the insights, what we have learned is that you can sit at home and through virtual mode, through your laptop or smartphone, you can still do everything. So I have been sitting at home for nearly first up to November. We started coming back to office in November. Again, the infections increased, particularly in Bombay, where people rely on public transport. Only people who have private transport can come to office. So except banks and government department, private companies have almost shut. So we realized that COVID brought a lot of hardships and problems and challenges. But at the same time, it opened a different door of our mind, window of our mind, which said that now we have to move to the digital era. So one is that there is no need for us to meet. You can still do. You know, we are talking today with the business world. Without this COVID, we would have met somewhere. But today, with the same efficiency, we are doing this interaction. So that's the realization. And during that period, we were dispersing money. We were collecting money from our customers. We were doing audit. We were doing annual general meeting. We were doing board meeting. Nothing stopped. Everything had been doing through virtual. So it created a impression in the mind. The mindset has changed where how do we carry our business next decade or 20 years? Simultaneously, you find that small, small startups which have come, whether it is in education or in delivery businesses or e-commerce, all these have made so much of billions of dollars of value, whether it is Baiju or Swiggy or Flipkart. All these have been successful, which have created value which is more than what Bajaj Auto or Asian Paints could do it in, HDFC could do in 30 years, 40 years, have been done in 5 years. So the world is going through a digital transformation, and there is a realization from businesses which are more relationship based, like us. You know, we are all catering to customers who are in the bottom of the pyramid. For example, if you take small truck owners, these small truck owners are vernacular language speaking. We may not be able to access them through any media, whether it is TV or print. You can't give advertisement and invite them. So we have put in place a relationship-based model where our relationship managers will access them, meet them, source loan proposals, and then collect. But over a period of time, slowly, the collections have become completely digital. You know, I was working in a company, I told you, Shriram Transport, which had 70% physical collections. But in our company, now completely we have resorted to digital. So what is happening is, the learning this period is that we have to now change our business model, bring in lot of digital initiatives and transform. Otherwise, the digital tsunami which is coming, we may not exist if you don't start this process. That's the learning.
So you spoke about the importance of modernization with respect to the challenges and various challenges being faced by the industry over a period of time, decades, right, altogether. And you spoke also about some of the advantage that you have been able to take from that digital transformation journey within the organization. So one is that collection part that you've spoken about, which has completely gone digital versus whatever percentage it was, but substantial on ground kind of a collection, right? Besides that, any other adoption of technology that comes to your mind, which you would have recently taken up to get the competitive advantage? Anything that you would like to highlight?
See, the moment that the pandemic started, this realization came, within few months, maybe by August, September, in 6 months, we realized that this is going to be the order of the day. So immediately we started the digitization initiative. See, earlier you had a technology which is supporting your data and information requirements. But digitization is doing the business itself. So we brought in a consultant, KPMG, to help us build this. So we are doing it for our retail business, affordable housing particularly, and commercial vehicle. So here what we are aiming is to give the frontline people digitization, an app through this, so that the customers who are not tech savvy, our customers, though they have the ability to use the phone, may not have smartphones. They are all driver turned owners and self-employed, assessed income category, small house borrowers, 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs and all that. So we can't expect them. So we'll have to make our people tech savvy, train them, give them an app so that they sit with the customer and help them conclude the transaction quickly. So here, the digitization is in a consumer business. Today you have companies like Policy Bazaar, where they say you can do anything. You have Bajaj Finance, which says whatever you want to buy, whether it is air conditioner or refrigerator, we give you in 5 minutes. So that is the kind of digitization which has happened. And you have credit bureaus which scans your repayment track record, income and all that. So today with Aadhaar card, with credit bureaus, with banking, which is going completely digital, for a consumer financing, consumer loan, you can do everything through digital. So you go to a consumer shop, you want to buy an air conditioner, 5 minutes, all will be done. If you have everything organized, you know, you have a earlier loan, you have an Aadhaar card, you have a PAN card, you have some, your ITR and all, it's 5 minutes, it will be done. But when it comes to an asset financing, like us, you know, we are financing a commercial vehicle buyer or a house buyer, there is an asset that comes into the picture, apart from the borrower. There are two things. So when it comes to an asset, everything cannot be done through digital. You know, if you are financing a house, then you have to do evaluation of the house, you have to do an inspection, and you have to do a lot of things, title check and all that, encumbrance, through sub-registrar office. Similarly, in the RTO office, you have to check a lot of records. All these things to become virtual will take time. You know, country is doing it, but they are creating registries, like your DMAT. Everything will come, that will take time. But in the meantime, we are moving towards digitization, but fully when it comes to the borrower, partially when it comes to the asset. With that initiative, we are hopeful that in the next 1 or 2 months, we will be launching it. And we will be able to give customers a delight of turnaround time. What has been taking 3 days, 4 days earlier will take less than a day. So for when it comes to KYC uploading, when it comes to credit bureau, but when it comes to document execution, you have to do it physically. But those documents can be kept in a scanned format to be accessed tomorrow. So everywhere the digital intervention is coming, but it will not be 100% to start with. Yes. But gradually I do see in a 5 to 10 year period, our country also will go completely digital. So this gives multiple advantages. One is on the turnaround time. The second is the cost of acquisition. The cost of loan processing becomes less. So that cost advantage can be passed on to the customer. The second is the productivity increases. So what a field executive could do in a month, a 25 lakhs loan processing, he may be able to do 35 lakhs. So these are all advantages which will reduce our operating expenses and increase productivity. Is going to be harder. So we are all, not only Indostar, the entire industry, NBFCs and banks are moving towards digitization. Who is going to have best product and who is going to use it is the decision making, you know, which you are going to do. But top to bottom, if the company's executives are aligned and believe that this is the way we have to move forward, then you will use it. Suppose the management team is not very enthusiastic about digitization and stick to the original earlier old method of my business is relationship based, so I'll continue, then over next 5 years they will lose out, because you know that customers also have, you know, I have worked in a company which is financing bottom of the pyramid, who have been paying cash to us, but those things have gone. Today everybody is on Google Pay and phone pay, they're all using this, UPI has come, and everything is in formats which can be transferred digitally. So I think the realization has come. Everybody is investing a lot of money to be ready to launch this so that they can take advantage of the transformation that is taking place.
Sure. Thank you so much for that elaborative answer. In fact, you've covered the whole customer journey in your reply to digital transformation journey. I had a very specific question on that because I felt that in your kind of industry, as you mentioned also, that the nature of the customer is quite different, right? So generally, when we talk about customer these days and we talk to the leaders, industry leaders, they are typically talking about the customers which are more like millennial, everything on the go, on the internet basis, right? So, I mean, on that, you have a different set of customer, they have a very different set of challenges, and you as an organization, a very different set of challenge to address those. And you have kind of beautifully covered that how you are trying to educate and, bring about that change in the way the business is done in a traditional way versus now you are emphasizing it for next 4 to 5 years. But on customer centricity, I will still like to ask you a question, which is, the customer experience in financial institutions is critical, which you also mentioned, right? And particularly around customer experience, what strategies you have adopted to focus on this critical success factor to potentially increase the top line and help boost overall economy? And you've spoken about digital transformation journey and the app and, all these efforts that you've been putting down. But help us answer in more in terms of what is the potential that it can contribute to the top line, not just of the organization, but I'm saying economy of the country at large, right?
Yeah. So, as I mentioned to you earlier, NBFCs have been filling gaps in the economy. There is a big brother, which is banks, which are there with a lot of liability strength and regulatory support. But what happens is there are sections of the economy in a large country like India, which banks have not been able to cater. That is where the importance of NBFC comes in the country. In spite of the challenges it has faced, it has been able to build successful NBFCs in the country. It is because they have been addressing gaps. For example, if you take consumer finance, today Bajaj Finance is a revelation, success story, where a consumer financing company could create 2-3 lakh crore of market cap of high valuations in a business which is crores of people it is managing and growing every. Similarly, Shriram Transport, a business which everyone considered to be difficult and challenging, risky, it created a business model. You take the very old business of pawning business, which a particular community was specializing. It has been corporatized by Muthoot and Manappuram, gold loan business. So every gap in the economy, NBFCs created a business out of it and thrived, which banks could not do. But there has been a very, very good partnership between banks and NBFCs, because banks lend money. Using that money, we have been lending to these sectors. So these niche segments of the economy, we have been creating a lot of business value and top line, which is contributing to the economy of the country. So I always felt that financing a second-hand truck business is not getting that much recognition as financing a new vehicle. But in every asset, what is very important is replacement. So if you finance the replacement, and today, government is talking about scrappage, end-of-life policy, and all that. So without a second-hand vehicle financier, you cannot modernize the fleet in the country, because old vehicles will have to be financed, churned, and then moved out slowly. So very useful role is being played by the NBFCs, which is creating a lot of top line and contributing to the GDP of the country, because everything is directly linked to the economy of the country. With the lessons we have learned, insights we have got from the pandemic, the entire industry, even in those niche segments where the customers are not tech savvy, is fine-tuning its strategies to digitize, modernize, to take advantage. So customer is centric to every digital initiative we are taking. Without customer, there is no business for us. So our borrower is critical to our success. And we address their needs, their gaps. And every NBFC, whatever be the business, is financing an entrepreneur. So the entrepreneur is a truck operator, and the entrepreneur is a home buyer, an entrepreneur is a gold loan buyer, an SME, who for his working capital, which he is not getting from bank, he goes to Manapuram, pledges his wife's jewelry and take money. So everywhere we are financing an entrepreneur, contributing to the economy. With the digitization, we are moving forward, very aggressive, very fast, and we will be ready in the next 2 to 6 months, 3 to 6 months, every NBFC will be ready with, you know, equally good product in digitization, which will help our customers to conclude the transactions quickly and get the loan. So that is going to help their business and also our business. So our top line will increase. We will be contributing more to the economy, but indirectly, we are empowering our customer, who is also a component of our economy. He is also contributing to the economy. So without money, the economy is not going to move. So banks are wholesale financiers. NBFCs are retail, but NBFCs cater to niche segments, which banks couldn't do. So our march towards success and contribution to the economy will continue. And it is going to increase much more because of the digitization, the new era we are going, and also the shakeout which has happened in the last 2 or 3 years have reinforced and made the NBFC industry stronger.
Great.
I would like to come in. In fact, it's been very, very enlightening hearing you, Sridhar sir. And what you just said, I remember a quote which was given to me by an NBFC CEO. He said, nobody wanted to lend to the segment that we forayed into first. And now banks are directly wanting to compete with us because now we have ensured and enabled them a path to profitability in terms of how to make lending profitable to that segment. And that corroborates a lot of what you've been talking about, Sridhar sir. And given digital is all about data, right, in terms of how do you get in front of consumer and get more and more consumer data and understanding of the segment. So banks no longer are content being the wholesale financer, that role that they used to play. Sometimes they want to directly compete with the NBFCs in the segment that they never used to venture out earlier. So I think it's a very, very interesting phase for the industry per se.
Very interesting. The kind of role that you explained of NBFC in developing the entrepreneurs at the root level, in the base level, right? Bottom of the pyramid, and developing the entrepreneurship there. In some sense, it's a direct correlation with, Atmanirbhar Bharat. The past couple of years have seen an increasing trend of platform business models emerging in financial services, particularly, right? We were talking about communities, we're talking about all these things. So particularly the platform business models, right? What is your perspective on its benefit for NBFC and the way forward?
Oh, absolutely. So I think that's... See, what platform business models hinge upon, right, always is your understanding of the segment, how intimately you understand that segment, because your ability to lend and ability to collect is what drives the profitability in the lending business. And NBFCs have mastered the art in a specific segment. Like Sir was alluding to earlier on, Muthoot has cracked the gold loan segment. Shriram and Indostar have cracked the used commercial vehicle financing segment, and they own the customer. what we have seen in the NBFC segment specifically is their customer retention rates are extremely high. The customers tend to be customers for life, right? So once you finance a used vehicle, if the customer is buying a new vehicle also, then he comes to the NBFC for financing, right? So the entire entrepreneur concept that Sridhar sir was talking about, which we call it Malak Chalak in the commercial vehicle industry, right? He starts owning a vehicle, and that's where he's called Malak and Chalak, because he's driving the vehicle too. And then he slowly graduates to owning a fleet, right? And through that entire journey, how his financial needs are being fulfilled is something where we are seeing a lot of platform concepts emerge. And just as a case in point, we are having some very interesting conversations with Shriram Transport, Sir's alumni organization, Shriram Transport Finance, in terms of how they can explore getting into a platform business model for the used vehicle segment, in terms of how do they, and the core intent has been in terms of cross-selling more products, be it working capital and how to end-to-end digitize your own products and partner products, because that is what will drive your valuations, right? Most of the NBFCs the sir was alluding to, given there was this capital issues, etc., they have to go to the market or private equity investors to raise money. And most of the private equity investors today look for digital in terms of what is the digital business model that they can foresee. How are you collecting data? And all that is leading all the NBFCs to think about a platform in terms of how do they efficiently collect data about the consumer to end-to-end service using your own products or partner products. So that's something that's an increasing trend that we are seeing in our conversations across the board.
Great. Thank you so much, Mr. Shankar.
So Daya, yeah. If I may come in, Sridhar sir, what's sure. your take in terms of where do you see platforms evolving in terms of where you're foreseeing, from where you're sitting? I think you have a holistic view of where the market is headed in terms, do you see platform business models picking up and gaining mainstream attention?
NBFC is, true to, frankly, we have been a brick and mortar, neighborhood branch, relationship-based business. Everything you do it in a physical manner. That is the specialization which NBFCs have done. But suddenly, this digital transformation is coming, which to some extent it was there, slowly it has been coming, but now pandemic, the COVID advantage is that it's opening up a different window of moving towards the digitization in a very, very big way. So we are adapting to this new format of moving away from a physical intervention to a digital intervention. So we are gearing up to that. And whatever you have been asking about platform innovation and all that will happen, but over a period of time. No, everything is being now understood by the NBFC industry. So as Mr. Shankar has said, a customer who comes into NBFC remains with us forever. So if he comes and buys an old vehicle, he doesn't stay as an old vehicle customer. His aspiration is to buy a new vehicle. So he upgrades slowly, through his credit performance, he upgrades to a new vehicle. So we keep him in that journey. And after buying a new vehicle, he becomes a multi-fleet owner. And slowly he moves to bank and access cheaper credit. We don't have any quarrel. So we are creating a good quality customer who will seek lower interest credit from bank. But during the period, he has been cured by NBFC by keeping him for decades. That's one. Second is, when a vehicle is funded, it remains with us till it goes to a scrapyard. So it changes from one person to another. but the new buyer is funded by us. So our funda is customer you retain forever, vehicle also you retain forever, and people also you retain forever. So our employees also we retain forever because we are engaged in a niche segment. You know, you can't keep training people and lose them to competition. So you keep them forever. So these people are not tech savvy. They have been becoming tech savvy. So we need to get into digitization, train them. Customers are not tech savvy. So our people have to become tech savvy. So we'll have to invest a lot of money in training and all that so that we give the customer a delight of a transaction experience plus turnaround time, lower cost, higher productivity, contribution to the economy bigger. All these will happen. But do not expect that everything will happen immediately. Mm-hmm. But it is a journey which will take few years for NBFCs to adapt to a new digital transformation and contribute. But the good thing is that we have realized it. We have moved fast and we are preparing ourselves to go through that journey.
With an advent of open credit enablement network and account aggregators, how do you see lending in specific and financial services broadly evolve in the Indian market?
Oh, that's a very, very... In fact, when you talk about open innovation, right? India is such an economy, and RBI per se, and sir alluded to it that regulator, he brought in the regulatory aspect earlier on in his conversation. RBI is one of the most progressive regulators in terms of globally. There have been a lot of accolades coming RBI's way because of how they are democratizing the entire level playing field, right? In terms of their goal is credit availability, right? If today an NBA and what Auchan is going to do is it is going to let an NBFC like IndoStar distribute its products anywhere, right? In anyone's platform. It could be Paytm today, it could be Paytm, it could be Amazon, it could be anywhere you could distribute your products, and you could embed any other lenders or any other service providers' products to distribute within your own platform. The key goal is the end consumer is going to be the extremely happy beneficiary in India because he is going to have wide variety of choices, right, made available to him to choose from. Whether the consumer wants to choose lender A or lender B, right, he has the choice. So basically, in a way, RBI is empowering the consumer to make the choice. And that is where the imperative is going to be, as sir was alluding to, the digitization aspect is dawned on. It is a journey. But more the digital, more the faster turnaround time, the lenders are going to win in the market. In terms of, because the consumers will not be wait. Whoever keeps the consumer waiting is going to lose the customer. So that's where what we believe is, one is democratization and credit availability from an end consumer perspective. And also, in a way, it is working as a driver for NBFCs and banks to digitize themselves so that they don't remain behind. That's the core. That's where fundamentally we see, where we've been having these conversations, that's where we see a lot of thrust and acceleration when it comes to digitization. One is COVID absolutely was a catalyst, and then this account aggregator and Auchan, Open Credit Enablement Network, because at the end of the day, it's all about the end consumer's need fulfillment, but also how efficiently banks and NBFCs fulfill the need.
And I think, Mr. Shankar, we heard Sridhar sir talk about the whole adoption journey, the challenges also in the process, the people not being so savvy, the customer not being so savvy, but, you know, building that whole, digital footprint and making sure that in the process, every stakeholder is trained, so to say, to kind of adopt it efficiently. That's something that has already begun. So, I think what you're saying need versus what I hear from Sridhar sir is already something, you know, in place. You know, it's the journey is on. It's in implementation, right? Sridhar sir, you spoke about a lot of challenges. You know, decades after decades being faced by the industry, but there is one challenge which has become very critical in today's era with respect to the cyber security and data breaches, right? I would like to have your views on that as well, sir, because a brand like yourself, where the whole business model, as you said, is built on the trust factor, right? So it's a trust of the consumer, trust of the employees, trust of the brand that, you know, reflects the success of the enterprise or the institution, right? How are you facing this challenge, and you know, what's your take on this?
This is a focus area, and you know, we are doing a lot of things to have this cyber security not impacted by that. And fortunately for us, you know, last year in May 2020, we had a global partner who came in and took a majority stake in Indostar. Brookfield, which is a $600 billion invested private equity in the world, second largest, found it attractive to invest in Indostar and partner with the management team. Because any NBFC to be successful, it is not sufficient that you have a business model on the asset side, but you should have strength on the liability side also. So in that respect, we have been very fortunate to have the partnership of Brookfield, which is backing the management team to build a low ticket, highly scalable niche segment of affordable housing, as well as second-hand commercial vehicle. So Brookfield is a global partner. So there are lot of global standards which we need to follow, whether it is accounting or technology or bribery, empanelment, so many things which we have to follow. So one of them is the cyber security. So they have very high standards. Already multiple audits have already happened. So that we are confirming. So our cyber security is there. Plus, global standard cyber security adoption is taking place through Brookfield. Then the third is our regulator is also looking into it. So we are completely in line with what is expected in this area. And in our case, it is not our own initiative plus the regulator. We are also conforming to the global standards and audits. So I think that is sufficient. As far as Indostar is concerned, we should be one plus in comparison with other agencies because of the global nature.
You know, you shared your complete journey, what has been done, what is being done, and also you shared a little bit about what is in store, what is something that you've been working on. But I would like to exclusively seek your inputs on as to, given next 2 to 3 years, the kind of mandate that you have within the organization, what are the key initiatives that you have in place or you have planned to be executed? If you can share those with us, sir.
So out of my last 4 years journey in this company, you know, fortunately or unfortunately, 2.5 years had been spent on survival. And during this period of the most challenging, you know, as I outlined, credibility crisis, GDP plus pandemic, fortunately, we have done a lot of right things at the right time by bringing partner, engaging into digitization. And we are a slightly unique company where we are transitioning from a wholesale business to retail. So any business entering is easy, exiting is tough. So it requires a lot of, you know, patience and perseverance to exit. So we are going through the transition, and we will be complete with that in the next 6 months. And we have after the Brookfield's partnership, we have put together a very aspirational 5-year plan. By, you know, for example, in the commercial vehicle financing business, we are 3,000-4,000 crores now, but I feel in the next 5 years, the kind of potential which is unfolding post-pandemic plus scrappage policy modernization initiatives of the government, we can look at growing this 10 to 12 times. So we are preparing, we are taking a lot of initiatives to do that. Similarly, in the affordable housing finance, you know that government has clearly stated its policy that housing for all, and particularly affordable housing is where the India Bharat stays. You know, people who want 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs for their requirements. So that is where we are addressing. So I think we are in the growth areas, niche segments, and we have put together a very aspirational plan. And as we have been able to attract capital, we have been able to attract talent also. Very good talent has come and joined this company. So we are going to have a very exciting 5 years. And every year we will be showing attraction, growth consistently to reach our destination in the next 5 years. So when I was in Shriram Transport in 2005, we were just 5,000 crores. And when private equities came and put money, they said at least 2 to 3 times you should grow in 5 years. But we grew 10 times. So normally, we underestimate our capability. I don't overestimate. I always underestimate and overperform. So I think the potential is very big. And as we have gone through downs, the next cycle will be up. So the next 5 years is going to be glorious for India, where in that cycle, well-capitalized, good processes, good products, good team, combined with an eye on digitization, is going to make the organization successful. So in that respect, I think we have done everything right and we are in that inflection point. So the next 5 years is going to be glorious. And answering your question, if the 5 years is glorious, it's going to be the destination. So the journey also, your 2 and 3 years also is going to be as exciting as it is going to be in the destination.
What are the growth strategies being adopted by NBFC in new normal? Sure, a lot of things have been spoken about, Sridhar sir. But since you've been interacting with leaders across industry, if there is anything that you wish to share here, helps us all learn from your that experience, so that would be great.
I think NBFCs are a very unique segment, and that's something there that we all understood from Sridhar sir's journey. He's been an NBFC expert through and through, right? Scaling Shriram, now on the Industra journey. What NBFCs bring to the table is their unique understanding of the segment, right? Customer segment. And either underwriting the human, as sir was alluding to, and underwriting the asset. Right? That's predominantly what lending is all about. And it translates into your ability to pay and intent to pay. So in terms, when we look at what NBFCs are doing, is like one of the NBFCs that I have personally been having a lot of dialogue and we did a lot of work for them, is they came up, they didn't want to lend to every customer of theirs, right? They said, cost of funds is getting expensive. I need to look at an alternate revenue stream. And this is IQPO. In terms of promoted by the Shrey group there, they came up with a marketplace saying that any customer who comes onto the marketplace, to my marketplace, doesn't necessarily need to be lent by me. I can actually get Axis, ICICI directly involved because I understand this segment, and they also have a heavy relationship-based model. So their entire relationship managers used to get leads. The leads were not... The loans were not entirely given by IQPO, and this was driven by the co-lending circular that RBI had put in. So they were now they were having an opportunity to pass the leads on to ICICI and HDFC and Accesses of the world. So predominantly they still own the customer, but still they variabilized the cost of lending. in terms, and that's something that increasingly we are seeing, where you have, when you want to hold the customer data and still service the customer, but you get partners on board. And all this is possible by the virtue of the end-to-end digitization, which most of the organizations are have already embarked on. So that's an increasing trend that we're seeing, and it's going to just accelerate, as I had alluded to earlier, by the virtue of OCEN and Open Credit Enablement Network and account aggregators are going to just drive the adoption further. So that's something that we are increasingly seeing in the market, is how do you still own the customer? Don't let go of the customer. That's critical. Like, the customer will stay with you, but as, because any NBFC customer is a customer for life till he reaches a certain credit profile, right? But still service the customer through and through and monetize it to the fullest ability is where we are seeing the industry headed.
Today, I feel so privileged that I could get a chance to speak to Sridhar sir and also interact with you, Mr. Shankar. I'm personally feeling after this conversation that the future is very bright. As Sridhar sir said, that the next 5 years going to be very glorious, and I'm really looking forward to that emerging Bharat in some sense through the contribution of each one of us, and especially leaders like Sridhar sir and industry experts like you, Mr. Shankar. I think collectively we will definitely make things happen. I am pretty confident on that. With that, I would like to thank you, Sridhar sir, for taking out time today and accepting our invitation to be on this, available for this interview. And thank you so much, Mr. Shankar. It was wonderful interacting with you, and lots of learning.
Thank you for Business World for this opportunity to share our views and perspectives. So we really enjoyed. Thank you very much for the opportunity.